page number 12.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim.
Allahumma salli wa sallam ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ahli. Five. The abasement of the corrupt. God the Exalted says, "He who comes to his Lord as a criminal, his shall be hell, in which he will neither die nor live." Quran. And he says, "Exalted is he. All those who commit sins think they will outstrip us. Evil is their judgment." Quran. The meaning of outstrip here is to evade and stand out of reach of God. And God the Exalted says, "He who disobeys God and his messenger, he has erred into manifest error." Quran.
ومن يعص الله ورسوله فقد ضل ضلالا مبينا. He who disobeys Allah and his messenger, فقد ضل ضلالا مبينا. Interesting how Allah has put the prophet next to him. Allah could have just said, "He who من يعص الله فقد ضل ضلالا مبينا." Which may not, but Allah is like, "Hey, he disobeys me, I'm my prophet." Disobeying the Prophet is disobeying Allah. You can't have one with the other. They're both connected. There's a association, which is why when we become Muslim, we have to be saying Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, and we have to say Ashhadu Muhammad Rasulullah. If we were to say Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Al Hayy, Al Qayyum, and all the 99 names of Allah, Al Hayy, Al Qayyum. All limbs. And you didn't say, "Wa ashhadu Muhammad Rasulullah," you wouldn't be a Muslim. If you mention all the names of Allah, I testify that Allah is one, the August, the Wise, all knowing, all seeing, Al Sami, Al Basir, Al Hayy, Al Qayyum, all the names. And you stop. You didn't say, "Ashhadu Muhammad Rasulullah," you're not a Muslim. Allah say, "Hey, the door to me is through him." So Allah says, "No matter how much you praise me, no matter how much the door that I've opened to come to me is through this man." Sallallahu alaihi wasallam. No other way. You said, "You're not a Muslim if you said all those things." Until you say, "Now you can come in."
The Messenger of God, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, said, "He who commits adultery is not a believer while he commits adultery. And he who steals is not a believer while he steals. And he who drinks alcohol is not a believer while he drinks." And he said, sallallahu alayhi, "When the servant sin, it becomes a black spot in his mouth."
La yazni zani hina yazni. That the one who fornicates, he is not a believer, he's not a mu'min. What he's saying is that he hasn't left Islam. Now, people who are literal, you know, just whoever, now he hasn't yazani, he hasn't. But the one who fornicate, he's not a mu'min, he's not a believer. He's left Islam, it's a major sin, yes, to fornicate and sleep with someone outside of marriage, haram. But it's certainly in the, you know, not aqidah, Ahl Sunnah wa Jama'ah, doesn't, you know, we're not like, what does light to come out? It's like it takes a major sin, or takes you out of the deen. A major sin takes you out of the religion. But the point is that wala yasriq as-sariq, wa yasriq wa huwa mu'min. The whole point is that there's a lack of iman when you do grave sins. There's a lack of iman. Otherwise, if you had full iman, you wouldn't fornicate, you wouldn't steal, you wouldn't drink alcohol, or you wouldn't do drugs. There's a lack of iman. There's something wrong in your faith. That's what it means here. That you're not, your iman isn't as full. The Prophet then says, "If a man does something wrong, Allah then places a black spot on his heart." If he makes tawbah, if he turns back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the three conditions, what are the three conditions? Then you have complete sorrow, al-nadim, one, al-iqla', to stop you in the sin, and the third and final thing, and that you have to promise yourself never to go back to that sin again. Should those three conditions for Tawbah be present, Allah Azza wa Jalla will remove this black dot from your heart. And if you didn't make Tawbah, if you just left it, if you didn't think about it, then this dot will remain. And then you make another sin, and that increases and increases, and the heart then becomes covered and darkened. And then what happens when your heart is darkened? No truth can come to it. Why? Because the heart is dark, like the depths of the ocean. Daylight, sunlight can't penetrate the depths of the ocean. It's dark, too dark. More of it. And same with people's hearts. When truth comes, when nur comes, the nur, the truth, haqq, cannot enter into the heart. The heart is, it's a shutter, there's a door, there's darkness, there's veils covering the heart. And the more these veils are removed, the more of the unseen you move to see. And that's the whole point of tasawwuf. You want tasawwuf? That's the whole point of tasawwuf. Clean the heart. Ridding yourself of bad characteristics and having good characteristics. And the one who has more characteristics, more good characteristics, more good qualities than you, then he has more tasawwuf than you.
This is his saying, exalted is he? No. But what they have wrought has covered over their hearts. Quran. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi said, hardness of the heart comes from
the verse of the Quran?
Sorry?
The verse of Quran?
No, but what they have wrought has covered over their hearts.
What they have?
Wrought has covered over their hearts.
What they have what?
Wrought.
Okay. كَلَّا بَلْ رَانَ عَلَى قُلُوبِهِمْ مَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ. That which they have earned, that has covered their hearts, darkened their hearts. There's rust on their heart.
Hardness of the heart comes from frequent sins. He said, moreover, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the servant's provision may be withheld because of the sin he committed.
SubhanAllah. Your provisions, your rizq, you getting married, you getting your job, you getting the right house or whatever else that you want from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this may be delayed or you may not get it because of a sin that you have done, as the hadith says. This chapter is dealing with what? Mentioning those things or the outcomes of sin. Mention the things that come about, the side effects of sin. In this world and the next. That's the context of this chapter.
And God revealed to Moses, alayhi salam, O Moses, the first of my creation to die was Satan, for he was the first to disobey me, and he who disobeys me, I consider him dead. Sa'i ibn al-Musayyib, may God's mercy be upon him, said, people honor themselves with nothing better than obedience to God, nor do they debase themselves with anything worse than disobedience to God. It is sufficient support from God, the believer, for one who sees his enemy disobeying God. Muhammad ibn Rasi said, sins in succession slay the heart. One of the virtuous predecessors has said, if you disobey God knowing that he sees you, you are scorning God's vision. But if you disobey him thinking that he does not see you, you are a disbeliever. Wahab ibn Warab, may God's mercy be upon him, was asked, does he who disobeys God find pleasure in worship? He answered, no, neither does he who merely intends disobedience.
People mention, I don't feel anything in my religion. I don't feel anything. I don't feel strong. I don't taste anything in my religion. Yes, people feel that all the time. People pray and fast and do zakah, and a lot of people are unhappy. They're not happy. Why? And they're prostrating and they're praying. Inside, the hearts are not happy. And if you push, if the truth was, you're not happy. Like, why? Because the worship is outward. Reading the Quran, outward. Just reading. Like, what? Those meanings that change in the whole world, those meanings that the Quran, had he sent down this Quran on the mountain, you would have seen the mountain like torn to pieces, you know, smashed to bits. Allah sent down the Quran. So this very Quran, these words that have come from Allah, have no effect on people's hearts anymore. These hadith will have effect on people's hearts anymore. The Sahaba, when the Prophet said something, the Sahaba changed. Now we have books after books, hadith after hadith, nothing happens. As if nothing is being said. And we don't taste anything. In our salah, the closest we are to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in our sujood. Yes? Most of us don't taste anything, don't feel anything. Don't taste any closeness, don't feel any closeness. However, the same person who's just sitting next to the radiator, they feel heat. The same person that's next to the window, they feel cold. The same person that's next to the wind and the fan, will feel coolness. The same person sitting in the draft of a door, will feel coldness. What happened to the same people? When they're doing sujood, don't feel any closeness to Allah. We feel the closeness of the radiator, we feel the closeness of the window. Eh? Even the closeness of the smell of the person next to us, we can smell. That makes that closeness. With the closeness of Allah and the sujood, we have nothing. Like, why? Well, our hands, if they have scent, feeling in it, you'll feel the radiator. If we're having heat receptors in our face, we feel cold through the window, looking through the draft. Our bodies are alive, but your heart is dead. If your heart is dead, what are you going to feel? Because your heart is going to feel closest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why Allah looks at the hearts. Hearts are muhim. And Allah mentioned yesterday the verse of Quran, 2 days ago the verse of Quran, on the day when la man wa la banun, money nor wealth will not be any success, illa ma'at Allah bi qalbin saleem, except for the one who has come to Allah with a heart that's saleem, clear, clean, and straight. That's the only thing that's going to benefit. And they're doing it. A lot of sin, a lot of good deeds are in and of itself. If you come like, I've prayed every single day, and I've gone to Hajj every single year, and I've done nothing haram. But that in and of itself, if that's done with showing off, if that's done with wanting to impress people, if that's done with a lack of sincerity, if that's done with a lack of presence of mind, what do you think maybe you're going to be going to heaven? That's not what the Prophet has told us, Allah. That's what the Prophet has told us. That the one who three men on the day of judgment will be brought close to Allah, and Allah will say to him, what did you do with the wealth that I gave you? I did a charity, I did this and I did that. Allah said, you lied. Kadibt. Why? Because you did it so people call you rich, so you can have a plaque. So people can say this and people, you know. And that's what your reward was, that's what you got. And that person, despite giving a lot of zakah, he didn't do anything haram outwardly. He wasn't cheap, he wasn't sleeping around, he wasn't doing this, didn't commit anything haram. But in his heart, he wasn't worshipping Allah correctly in his heart. And what happened? Khalas. Second person, an alim, scholar. What do you do with the knowledge I gave you? I told people, I told people the book, I told people the sunnah, I told people the deen, I told people the sharia, I told people the hadith, the fiqh, and took that. Allah said, you lied. You did it so people can call you knowledgeable, so people call you shaykh, so people can call you maulana, so people can respect you, and that's why you did it. And that's what you got, that was your reward, but today, you're going to be sent to hellfire. Sent to hellfire. Who's this? Not the one who drank alcohol. Not the one who slept around. Not the one who cheated. Not the one who had interest. A scholar. What was his crime? His heart wasn't sincerely doing things for Allah. Which most people can't see that. Allah, nobody can see it. Most people can't see that. And the third person, one who's doing jihad, Sibillah, died. Fine, for Allah's sake. Allah said, you lied. You died so people can call you shuja'. Yeah, and they did. That was your reward. Today, no reward. What was his? What did he do wrong? He died in jihad. In his heart. Inna Allah la yudhir ila suwarakum wa la ila ajsadakum lakin yudhir ila kullul mughum. Very important. So where are your hearts? Where are our hearts? Our hearts are trying to impress people. Our hearts are trying to show off. Allah wants sincere Muslims, doing things sincerely. Even when we try to debate with people, it has to be sincere. We try and debate. The debate, Imam Shafi'i said, I never debated with a man, except that I made dua that the proof would come on his tongue. That's a sincere person. That's not about me being right.
One more. No, neither does he who merely intends his obedience. The virtuous precept is to say, sins are the harbinger of disbelief. In summary, continually indulging in the sin is a sign of having fallen from the sight of God and deserving of his displeasure. He who persists in these detestable and unmerciful, he is the
devil. Could you repeat that again? Repeat that.
In summary. In summary, continually indulging in the sin is a sign of having fallen in the sight of God and deserving of his displeasure.
Someone continuously doing sin, always doing haram. The sign that you've fallen in Allah's eyes. You've fallen in Allah's eyes. The sign that Allah has left the person is that person is always busy talking about other people. That's a sign. You want to know if Allah has left you, if Allah is no longer with you? If you're busy with other people, he went there, he said this, he did that, he did this, and he went there, he said this, and he did that. Khalas, that's a sign that Allah has left you. And the sign that Allah is with you is when you're always busy with what? The Prophet said this, the Prophet said that, Allah said this, he said that, Allah said that, the Prophet said this, the Sahaba said this. The difference between the one who said Allah said, the Prophet said, the Sahaba said, and the person so-and-so said this, I heard him saying this, she said that, he said this about you. Whoever is busy with creation in this life will be busy with creation in the grave. Whoever is busy with the creation in the grave will be busy with the creation on the day of judgment. And whoever is busy with the creation on the day of judgment will enter into hell. And the person who is busy with Allah in this life will be busy with Allah in the grave. Whoever is busy with Allah on the day of judgment. And whoever is busy with Allah on the day of judgment shall enter into Jannah. InshaAllah, Ameen. Allah make us from those people in Jannah. Ameen.
He who persists in this detestable to the unmerciful, he is the devil's ally and the believer's object of disgust. So beware, my brother, of exposing yourself to God's displeasure and chastisement by disobeying him. Should your soul incite you to sin, remind it of God's absolute awareness and sight of you. Place fear into it by recalling God's warnings of the painful torment and formidable punishment that awaits those who disobey him.
This is what we mentioned previously in the book before. If you find yourself getting lazy, if you find yourself inclining towards doing sin, put fear. Hell. And hellfire is like this, and the fire of hell is so extreme, you can't take it, it's going to burn our skins, and then all these punishments and these type of things, there's going to be molten lead, you're going to drink it, it's going to rip through your stomachs and these type of things, and put fear. One of the old ones, Salihin, his nafs, he saw this woman, and his nafs inclined, said to him, go fulfill your desires. And he said to his nafs, if you want to fulfill, if you want me to fulfill the desires with her, let's see how long you can take. If you can be patient with holding this fire. Fire is a fire, and nearby, if you can have patience with the hand and the fire, if you can do that, khalas, I'll give you what you want. What the nafs say? The fire of the next world is multiple more times more severe. That's what some people should do. The nafs would be tempted to do this, God, the candle. You can't have to take a candle. If you want to go down that route, then there's going to be some punishment. If you want a taster of the memories of a punishment that's nowhere near that punishment, it's going to give you a taste. Do this. And a candle. That's what he used to do.
Had it been that the punishment for committing sin was merely being debarred from reaching the rank of the foremost at Sawabin Bun, or being deprived from the reward of the most excellent in deeds and muhsineen, this alone would have been a sufficient deterrent.
These high ranks of being close to Allah, these high ranks being very, very close to Allah, if that was the only punishment from your sin, you being deprived of having closest to Allah, that would be enough. If you need reality, not being close to Allah. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ يَعْبُدُونَ. So you mean worship. But you have to, before you worship, you have to know. And if you, that's the whole point of knowing. the science of the soul is ma'rifa to know Allah. Know Allah, know Allah. Nobody knew Allah more than the Prophet.
What then, when indulgence in sin leads to shame, hellfire, and the wrath and displeasure of the compeller before which the heavens and earth cannot stand? We ask God for safety by His grace.
Allah al-afiyah. On top of that, not only will you find distance, being far from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you also will be punished by hell, you're going to be exposed on the day of judgment and so forth. As if that wasn't enough. People like to, imagine you have a friend, and your friend turned away from you. Or your wife, or your, you know, a good friend doesn't want to speak to you. Feel upset. Why is he turned away from you? And how many people, you know, that's their relationship with Allah. And how many people Allah's turned away from them? They don't even know anything. Allah's turned away. You get upset when people don't talk to us, when people are not friends with us anymore. I'm not talking to you. Mm-hmm. We shake hands and use his hand away from you. He smiles at everybody, it's away from you. How do you feel? You're upset. Imagine Allah. So be careful not to do things that will make Allah not look at you anymore and turn away from you. Bismillah.
6. Delight in obedience. The Messenger of God says, he who is pleased by his good deeds and displeased by his evil ones is a believer. O believer, when God grants
you. The Prophet said, whoever is happy with his deeds and upset at his bad deeds, he's a believer. So you fasted the whole Ramadan, alhamdulillah, be happy. InshaAllah. Tawfiq, Allah. You've read some Quran, be happy. You've done the i'tikaf, be happy. You've tried your best, mashallah. You've left things at the haram. You've prayed fajr every day, mashallah. You haven't missed any fajrs. Alhamdulillah. And if you've done anything wrong, oh, astaghfirullah. Yeah, I'm happy. I didn't do enough. I should have done more. I missed a fajr. I didn't catch the takbir to ihram with the imam, let alone the prayer behind the imam. The takbir to ihram, the opening of Allahu Akbar. The Prophet said that the best of the prayer is the opening takbirat al-ihram, Allahu Akbar with iman. That's where the most reward is. People are taking their time, maybe people are even praying. On Yom Al-Qiyamah, people are gonna I give all the wealth in the world to come back and just to catch one prayer in the mosque, or the takbirat al-ihram, or reading the Quran, or doing dhikr, or coming to a class. The people in the next world, in the barzakh, if they could come back, if they could give everything to come back to this world and do one sajda, they would. Why? Because the reality of this world is a wing of an ant, a wing of an insect. If they could come back and pray, read one verse of Quran, they could. And these opportunities come by all the time. Copies of the Quran all over the place. Poof. And how many people will be reading the Quran and the Quran is cursing him? Why? Because he's reading verses of Rahmah, reading verses of how to be, and he's doing the exact opposite. The Quran tells him to be truthful, he's cheating. The Quran tells him to have mercy, he's to have no mercy. The Quran tells him to lower his gaze, he doesn't lower his gaze. So the Quran will curse him. Why are you just giving the Quran lip service? Even people, there are some people's prayer, their prayer curses them. لَيَعَقُ اللَّهَ كَمَّا لَيَعْقُنِي. May Allah lose you as you've lost me. Why? Because people's presence of mind and the prayer wasn't there. They weren't really thinking of Allah, they weren't concentrating on Allah, just up and down, up and down, up and down. And what's worse, how many people think that's normal? How many people think that the prayer is just outward? When we say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, what do you mean? In the name of Allah, most merciful. Most merciful. More merciful than your mother, more merciful than anybody else. And this mercy, is one portion out of 100 portions, 99 portions of all of it, 99 portions of Allah's mercy is reserved for the day of judgment, and all the mercy we see in this world and everything around is that one portion of mercy.
O believer, when God grants you the good fortune of acting in His obedience, let your joy be great. Thank God in abundance for honoring you with His service and choosing you to attend to Him, and ask Him to accept by His grace whatever He has made easy for you in the way of virtuous behavior.
Alhamdulillah, Allah has made us Muslim. Alhamdulillah, that's a big ni'mah. Allah could have made us non-Muslims. Alhamdulillah, Allah has made us people who are following Ahl Sunnah wa Jama'ah. But that's what people may think. Alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us the ability to come pray asr. Alhamdulillah, Allah has given us the ability to stay in the mosque and to sit, which is i'tikaf for those who are not staying the full 10 days. Right now, we're mu'takafin. Allah's blessed us. Alhamdulillah, Allah has blessed people's hearts to incline towards coming to this class. That's how Allah feels. It's a blessing. How many people's hearts are like thinking about everything else? How many people are not even fasting? But Allah moved people's hearts. What? Towards Zayn? Towards hearingness. Towards hearing the great words of the Awliya Salihin. Allah wants the khair for you and I. Allah wants to hear these words as a reminder for you and I, inshaAllah ta'ala. So that we may be reminded. We're telling you a proof for you and a proof against you.
Ali, karamullahu wajah, said, be more anxious for your works to be accepted than for them to be done. For no accepted deed is small.
Say it again.
Be anxious for your works to be accepted rather than for them to be done.
Shukri.
For no accepted deed is small.
Most of the same, Sayyidina Ali, you'll find in the books of Tasawwuf. Full. Kuni bi qabul al-amal aham minkum bil-amali. Be more concerned with Allah accepting your deeds more than you doing the deeds. How many of us now we think, oh, I wonder if Allah has accepted the 23 or 24 days of fasting that I've done? I start off here. Allah taqabbal sayyamina wa salatina wa du'ana. As the old people say, you always say, Allah, Allah taqabbal sayyamina wa salatina wa sayyamina wa salatina wa du'ana. Oh Allah, accept our prayer and our fasting. We don't think about that. We pray. Robots pray. Read the Quran, come to the class, up and down, Jum'ah after Jum'ah, Khutbah after Khutbah. Allah ask. The ulama would say they spend 6 months asking Allah to accept their Ramadan. And 6 months asking Allah that Allah will give them life to live long enough to catch the next Ramadan. That's the Salaf. When we talk about Salaf, people talk too much about Salaf. Salaf. The Salaf in the past 6 months making dua continuously, oh Allah, for 6 months. 2 weeks after Ramadan, people have forgotten Ramadan. Yalla, if people even fast the 6 days, which everybody here should fast the 6 days, and if you can fast them straight away, even better. You should ask Allah, accept our fasting and our prayer and our zakah and everything that we've done. Allah, forgive everything that we've done, that which we know, that which we don't know, and that which we've forgotten about. Allah, ask Allah to forgive us all. Muhammad Hadi Shaykh, inshaAllah.
Always acknowledge your shortcomings in fulfilling your duties to your Lord.
Now he said in the beginning, be happy. Allah has made you Muslim. Allah has made you Ahl Sunnah wa Jama'ah. Allah has come and made you sit in the class. Now don't get led astray and think, oh, mashallah, I'm better than everybody else. Allah's made me from this Ahl Sunnah wa Jama'ah and so forth. Don't get led astray because Allah can go what? Has led shaitan away, he can lead you astray and take you away. Just because now you're sitting where you are, thinking the way you think, doesn't mean you're going to die. Al-ibrah, the point is when on your deathbed. Bihusna khatima, inshaAllah.
Even when you are most determined and energetic in his obedience, for his rights on you are immense. He created you from nothing. His favors overflow upon you. He treats you with his grace and generosity. You obey him by his power and his ability. And you worship him by
you
his
You obey Allah through his? His power and ability. Allah gives you the ability to worship him. Even you, subhanAllah, it's not even us doing it. It's Allah has given us the ability. Allah sees the hearts want him, Allah open up and then give you the ability to fast and do all these great works.
Beware of soiling the robe of your faith and blackening the countenance of your heart by committing that which your Lord has forbidden. Should you fall into sin, even if it is infrequent, hasten to repent. Return to obedience. Feel
that. What was that verse? Sa'ihu ila. Oh, that's not great. be quick to do what? To ask Allah for forgiveness. سَيَا وَسَارِعُوا ذَا مَخْفِرَةً مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ وَجَنَّةً عَرْضُهَا السَّمَوَاتِ. So be quick. Allah said, be quick to ask forgiveness. Ashirat, be quick to ask Allah for forgiveness. Why? Allah is already saying, look, I know you want to sin. I know you're going to make mistakes. I know there will be things that you want to do that you're proud of. I know. I created you. I know. But then Allah said, وَسَارِعُوا. Come quick to me, I'll forgive you. رحيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وسارعوا be quick. Allah doesn't say you're going to do this and then come back to me. Straight away Allah says come to me quickly for forgiveness. Like a mother says to a child, come to me, خلاص I'll look after you.
Should you fall into sin, even if it is infrequent, hasten to repent, return to obedience, feel remorse and ask for forgiveness and abundance. Remain fearful and apprehensive, for the believer remains fearful and apprehensive to the extreme, even when he is.
Don't forget to slow down.
Sorry. Remain fearful and apprehensive, for the believer remains fearful and apprehensive to the extreme, even when he is sincere in his obedience and service. You already know how the prophets behaved, even though they were inerrant, and the saints, even though they are guarded, they were fearful and wary. Though their works were good and their sins rare or non-existent, you are more worthy of this fear and anxiety than they. For they were better acquainted than you with the immensity of God's mercy, better thinking than you of God, more truthful than you in hoping for His pardon, and more hopeful than you in His generosity and grace. Follow in their footsteps, and you will be safe and secure.
Ameen, inshaAllah. May Allah make us from those who follow in the footsteps of the Prophets and Anbiya. وصالحين إن شاء الله. Next chapter.
7. The four obstacles to obedience.
What are there any obstacles to you practicing your religion? Any obstacles to you living as a Muslim in Cardiff or Wales or England or Malaysia or wherever you may be? What are the main obstacles? Four obstacles to you practicing your religion. Four things. Share the book between you so you can see. I'll tell you, what's the four options then? Let me know.
The four obstacles of obedience. Because the abode of this world is found in hardship and trial, needed with troubles and distress, and filled with preoccupations and distractions, the things that divert one away from the acts of obedience are found. As are those things that incite to transgression. Those distractions are numerous, but may be reduced to four categories.
So this is the Imam Abdullah ibn Ali al-Haddad, famous scholar from Yemen, writing this several hundred years ago. Here are four things, obstacles to you being a good Muslim. First thing is what?
The first is ignorance. The second, weakness of faith. The third, long hopes. And the fourth, eating illicit or dubious food.
MashaAllah. These are the four things. Quite interesting, yeah? Four things that obstacles to you being a good Muslim. Not sinning. Jahil. Ignorance. If you're ignorant, what are you going to do? You're going to sin. Okay, there you go. You're going to be far from Allah. A weak iman. If your iman is weak, you're going to do haram things. طيب. Long hopes. When I retire, I'll go to the mosque. When I get married, I'll stop messing around. I'll stop praying. Long hopes. Who said you're going to live that long? Who said you're going to live to get to the age of retirement and come to the mosque? Come to the mosque now. They have long hopes. And the fourth thing, eating haram and eating things that from dubious sources. He who eats haram does haram. Simple as that. Tayyib, bismillah.
We shall briefly discuss each of these four, God willing, to demonstrate how blameworthy they truly are, and to show how to guard oneself and free oneself from them. Success is from God.
Ameen, inshaAllah. So tomorrow we're going to find out how to protect ourselves from the four obstacles that prevent us from being, having strong iman. And you've seen, when you do yourself, when you've done something haram, or you've done something wrong, or you made a mistake, you've done some sin. Most of the time it's because of ignorance. You forgot Allah. You were ignorant of Allah. And what's the next thing? You had weak iman. You had weak iman. And the third word, what?
Long hope.
Long hopes. Allah forgive me. Oh, we're going to then. When I fast on the fast of Arafah, you know, all my past sins forgiven, Allah is most merciful. Long hopes. Allah forgive me. Long hopes. And the last thing, eating haram. Not really bothered to wear. You know, not looking at the ingredients, making sure the ingredients are halal, or where you're buying your food from. I close your eyes and say, Bismillah, I need. That's not our way. That should be hard. Or people say to people, don't worry, you can look at women as long as you don't touch them. Some people say that. You can look, you can't touch. No, that's not what our Prophet taught us. The Prophet taught us. The first look, by accident, you're forgiven. The second look, you held accountable. And all these looks darken your heart. You hear people saying, when people, man, you can look, don't touch. That's when you go and buy something in the shop. You're buying something in the shop, right? They say, you look, but don't touch. Buying something from a shop, or electrical equipment, you can look, but don't touch. That's how they put a darkness in your heart. You touched it. You made dating the computer or the equipment.
It's probably
Allah. So we'll look at this in detail tomorrow, inshallah. Any questions?